What's up, guys? This podcast is sponsored by Yak Attack. It's yakattack.us. And Yak Attack is the leader in the kayak fishing industry, specializing in kayak fishing rigging solutions. As kayak anglers themselves, they are tightly integrated into the kayak fishing community and are acutely aware of what this sport needs. They are fishermen. They fish. And Luther is here at this tournament today. I'm going to try to get him in here today. So, yeah, Luther is here. He caught a trout this morning, posted up on Facebook. This all starts with the gear track and the Mighty Mount. The gear track comes in different sizes and colors. The screw ball is the part that connects to the gear track that's attached to your boat, and everything attaches to that. Well, a variety of rod holders, camera mounts for still cameras and GoPros, light poles with the day flags that fold into the flag as a carrying bag, fish finder mounts with for the batteries and the transducers themselves you go over the side of your boat, the black pack crate system, and the white pack. That's a supersized crate system that you can carry all your stuff to your boat and load it all in. Crates are a great way to go, and the black pack is one of the top of the line crates. All this stuff of Yak Attack is made in the USA. This month we're still talking about the panfish portrait and the dog bone combo. One of the most important things if you're serious about doing pictures and you're by yourself a lot. These are the perfect self-portrait shots, as good as somebody being there with you. The panfish portrait and camera mount and the dog bone combo pack can be used together as a 19-inch tall camera mount, or separate as two different camera mounts. So you can have one in front of you, one behind you, get different angles, have a video camera on one and a still camera on the other one. The pivoting head with adjustable friction disc on the panfish portrait gives the horizontal panning, and the dog bone fully articulates for the maximum flexibility to help you get that perfect shot over the shoulder, in front of you, or even angled under the water, as we call the Rob Choi shot. All this stuff is at yakattack.us. And so what I'm doing tonight is we are here at the TKAA tournament. Lee's not here yet, but this is going to be kind of sporadic. We're going to be going in and out of having guys in. There's about 250 people here, so we're going to try to get as many people in and out as here as we can. It's going to be sporadic, so if you're watching this live, we're going to be, you know, cutting off the sound, we're going to leave the video running, go grab somebody, come back, and do about, you know, 20 minutes, maybe, you know, 15, 20 minutes. It's pretty busy out there, so I don't want to hem people up for too long. And then we're just going to try to do it all night, but if you want to watch it later on, it's going to be all cut together and tight, so it won't be so bad. But hang in there. I'm going to take a little break and go find Lee and get somebody, one of our first guests. We got a lot of people here, so this is going to be pretty cool. Hang on, y'all.
Are we rolling?
Yeah.
We're rolling.
Hey!
All right, this is podcast number 32. It is September 27, 2014, and we are at the TKAA, Tidewater Kayak Anglers Association, annual charity tournament, and it's going on right now. Weigh-ins just happened. TKAA.org is their website. Heroes on the Water is one half of the charity, right?
Or is exactly. It's one of two charities.
One of two charities. HeroesOnTheWater.org and ProjectHealingWaters.org. Come in here, Rob. You're going to sit here too if you got time.
Yeah,
because you had an interesting day. And we got Lee, and we've got Tom Vanderhuizen from your Heroes on the Water.
I've got a new name now. Tom Vanderhuizen. Vanderhuizen over there.
Okay, got it. Yeah.
That doesn't move back anymore.
You all right? Oh, we don't get all right.
Yeah.
So this is the 10th annual TKAA tournament, right?
Yeah.
And the first, you know, we start off real slow. I think we had Wayne on last week, 2 weeks ago.
Yep.
2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. But it was the last one we had.
No, I was.
No, you're sure you were.
Yeah, Rob came last week, but he's not memorable. So
yeah, not eventful at all.
Rob is unepic. So.
So yeah, so he came in and pretty much gave us a scoop on things. But tell us about Heroes on the Water.
Heroes on the Water is a nonprofit organization. We're a 501c3.
What's that? Is that a
Yeah, it's a tax. Like it's a tax thing.
Is that the thing you say after you say?
Yeah. You may be able to take it off on your taxes.
You got to say that afterwards.
Yeah, it's always important, you know, because businesses and everything, they like to donate. They want to know that it's going to a good organization.
Yeah.
And stuff.
Yeah.
So,
and when they can look at it that way.
And here's, that's right. Here's
a lot of not so legit ones out there.
Right.
Yeah. Well, we won't talk about that. But yeah, we're the Tidewater chapter. We originally started, I don't know, back in 2009 or something like that by Corey Ruth, you know, and you know his lineage on TKA, a family father of TKA, the guy that started the charity tournament, the Kayak Fish for Charity tournament, and he also started the Tidewater chapter of Heroes on the Water. He did it for a couple of years, and I took it over. And what we do, we take out wounded and injured vets kayak fishing, and everything we do is absolutely free.
And it's also it's been an ongoing thing for a while around here. It's, you know, like you said, it's been going on for a while. It's been helping out a lot of guys because those guys get out there. And the thing is, these guys are hemmed up in the hospital a lot. You know, they're not getting out a lot. Well,
it's a variety of guys and gals. You know, because you got to remember that there's a lot of women that serve, and they suffer the same injuries. Right. You have injuries. You have physical injuries, but you also have injuries that aren't seen. You know, PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, can be brought on by a multitude of different scenarios that they're involved with, and then also traumatic brain injury. And so the folks that we're taking out are the wounded and injured vets. It's not necessarily, it doesn't have to be battle wounds or whatever. There's all kinds of different wounds that can happen in the military because just the nature of everything that they do in training and while they're deployed and all that. So the people that we gear towards are the folks that are in the hospital, folks that are at a warrior transition unit or a community-based warrior transition unit, but also folks that have retired or left the military that, you know, just need something to give them something, some normalcy to their life.
And a lot of the guys that, you know, have been through it, and some of those guys are coming back and helping out also.
Right. Absolutely. I mean, our volunteer pool is made up of civilians such as myself. I'm a civilian, I never served. But we also have
the haircut.
We have veterans. Yeah. Well, I was a Navy brat, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, Dad was like, hey, you're going to the barber or I'm going to cut it, you know? Needless to say, the barbers were his buddies that were in the military too. So. But no.
So your scalp has been rang.
Yeah, we're going to probably hook you up on that too.
I've had it done. I know what it's like.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. You're a Marine, right?
Marine,
that's
right.
Well, I wasn't going to say former because I know you guys have a tendency of putting people in neck blocks and stuff like that. There's no former Marines. But I forget where we were going.
No, there's no ex-Marines.
Yeah. Oh, is that what it is? Yeah, yeah, okay. All right. I don't remember what your last question was. So.
No.
The two old guys here, you know, these are two young guys.
What I wanted to say, though, I mean, it is an actual therapy for these people. I did an interview with you like 2-3 years ago, and you mentioned there were actual like brain studies and stuff like that where actually it proves that this is something that really helps these people.
Yeah, those studies weren't necessarily for Heroes on the Water, but they prove that there's activities that go on and that allow the veterans and people with traumatic brain injury to relax, and it makes some of those connections again.
And you guys take out their families too sometimes when they're involved. So I mean that's pretty awesome.
Absolutely.
There's also you do some stuff that's not in the kayak too, didn't? And wasn't there some stuff?
You remember the Billy, discharge?
The discharge stuff that.
Yeah, and that's badass, because that's. You're carrying
that was insane. That was insane.
That's some of the best fishing in people. I mean, even anyone will ever experience in their entire life is some of the best fishing. I mean,
being right there.
Those reds are no less strong in that creek than they are in any other creek.
Oh, they're stronger because you're out there freezing your butt off and you're all stiff and everything. You're like, wee!
Yeah.
Also, how cool is that you're making this happen in the middle of winter too? That you're.
Yeah.
Granted,
yeah.
I don't know how often you guys are gonna be able to do that specifically, but it's still.
Yeah.
It's,
unfortunately, that location is gonna close down in December. So, right. They're shutting down that energy plant that's there, electricity plant. But we found out that we can't do anything in this area.
Sad about the trout last year. Yeah. Wait till all the stuff that used to haul it up in the river freeze in that fresh water that's in there.
That's a real shame.
Oh,
but our normal events, we run April, May time frame and go through September, October, and we're doing a couple of those a month when we can.
You know, you don't have to wear waders.
Right.
You want guys to be comfortable out there.
So I hear a lot of things, like a lot of people talk about wounded warriors. Is that a part of Heroes on the Water, or do you work with the same organization? Is it completely separate organization?
That's a separate organization. We try to work with a lot of different organizations. Okay. We've actually worked with Wounded Warriors.
They do all kinds of stuff. Yeah. So I mean, Heroes of the Water is pretty specific to water, but Wounded Warriors is everywhere. I mean, they do everything.
Right, but we've also teamed up with the USO. We've tried to team up with Project Healing Waters in small ways, and that's going to expand and all that. But like I said, we do the majority of our stuff in the summer months when it's warm, spring, summer, and fall. But in the wintertime, we found out that we couldn't really get on the water. It's not safe. You know, the 120 rule of water and air temp combined just didn't apply. So we started looking around. We knew the discharge was there. We asked, reached out to the Dominion Energy, and they welcomed us, bought lunch and everything. And I think we did like four or five trips out there. Started off small.
That's awesome. They did all that,
especially in the wintertime.
And
it's really right down on the water there. It's really not that cold.
You're in a ditch. So
I know. It was cold as
hell. Yeah, imagine. Shit.
It was cold. It was cold out there a couple times, dude. But I mean, it's awesome. But you kind of forget about that, and when you see the vets and their family and the kids reeling in fish, I mean. That first one that we did, I think we had like 20 people out there combined, and there were well over 200 fish that were caught.
Yeah,
right.
And of course, Ben Hoover, our secretary of the chapter, he's out there tagging stuff.
Oh, he racked up some numbers.
Yeah, he racked up some serious numbers.
Where are those fish? Because everybody's always got theories about, these fish or those fish. From the precaution or whatever. That's like, it actually ends up that it is. Yeah. It is the same.
And they were all within slot, and then there was actual citation trout that were caught out there too.
Nice. The tagged cobia we caught with Jay a few weeks ago, the one we were talking about, with Jay and Alex, we caught that tagged cobia. Yeah. We got the information back on it. It was tagged May of last year at 35 inches, and it was 39
inches?
It was 39 and a half, 40 this year.
So you're saying grew good.
Four inches left.
Since May?
No, May last year.
Oh, so that's a good long time. That didn't grow that fast as much.
Five inches.
Maybe at that size, you're starting to bulk out.
Yeah.
I've grown that fast before. I'm surprised you didn't ask Wayne Bradley about that. He's done that too. I just had a guy here. He comes up to me. He's talking about this donut. Hey, I've got this stuff. Can we put this out? He looks at me. He goes, "Oh, you're not Wayne." I'm like, "Yeah, we look a lot alike." It's like nobody comes up and says, "Hey, man, are you Rob Choi?" I love that guy.
He calls me and he texts me this morning. Actually, before I even wake up. It's on my phone already. By the time I wake up, I'm looking at it, he goes, "I'm heading out." I'm like, "All right." I look at the winds, and it's like blowing 20. I'm like, it's okay.
Bad this morning.
Yeah.
I thought it was really flat this morning. Because when I woke up at 8:20, it was really calm.
8:20.
I'm serious. I slept at 8:20 today.
That's right. Even now, I was at work and it was still, I counted the strokes, and it was average of 20 to 22 between each piling set, which is a lot. Here's the thing, if it was southwind, a lot of people, we talked about this last time, direction of the wind counts a lot for where you're trying to go. Like if it was a southwind, it comes off the land, it wouldn't be nearly as bad.
If it was a straight north wind, that's not so bad. It's straight headwind is not so bad as these curving winds. Northwest, you had northwest today.
It was I got to where I wanted to get to, and I put my baits down and I got one. So
good job, Croker.
It was frozen bunker actually. Fresh bunker.
Oh, cool.
I bought from the store and.
I thought you were just asking if you caught a croaker. I was getting excited.
Croaker master right here.
No, croaker liar.
So I had a good time. I hooked up pretty quick. I had my 48. Hopefully, we'll see what the judges.
But there has been this tournament. The Reds are here, and you guys got out. I wouldn't have gone, but
yeah, was
out.
By the end of the day, it was really nice.
Yeah,
you have to be in by then.
In by two,
by four.
Four.
You have to be in.
Yeah. See,
four.
If we weren't doing this, you and I could have gone this afternoon after everybody left.
Yeah,
and it would. But.
But yeah, so that's the thing.
Same job.
But there's three. We hear there's three big reds caught.
I was there for one of them, and the other one. I decided to end up just taking off just because I was exhausted from the paddle out, and part of me feels like maybe I should have stayed. Part of me also thinks if I had my fish by 9:15, I could have hauled ass back in, but I would have been like on land by 10:30, and then I had options to do, you know, the slam if I wanted to, but
right.
I saw the other guy catch his, and then Shane Hatcher was out there. He ended up hooking up three. Jay Brooks ended up showing up. Yeah, he got Jay two. Caught. So I was like, now I really want to stay, because I've never broken 50.
Jay Brooks was on a kayak?
No.
Oh, okay.
I've never broken 50, and there's been a lot of 50-plus caught, yeah. And I really wanted to stay out and maybe catch one of those.
I think I've landed two of them so far.
Yeah, Jay had a 53 today.
Yeah.
It was beast.
Yeah.
Nice. Kevin got a 53 the other day.
Yeah.
So monster drum.
50 and 30 around.
Like 60.
It was only 30 around.
Yeah, that's really a coincidence talking about this 50, 51, 53. I'm actually 54 years old. So.
Are you?
Yeah, yeah.
Are you?
Yeah.
Damn, you don't look that old.
I know. Yeah. It's weight, man. You pop the wrinkles out.
You know what? Actually, that is what I heard. I heard a story about William Shatner says that every year he gains like 5 pounds to get rid of the wrinkles. Yeah.
That's why we do it.
It's your birthday tomorrow, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right. Happy birthday.
So he's there's a lot of wrinkles.
29 years old.
Is that like every year or his birthday? Yeah, birthday.
I don't think I did last year. I don't think it was. I couldn't get out last year.
It was the day before or the day after.
Right, yes, totally.
We got little ones.
Yes.
That was
my birthday. We went on the Eastern Shore. Yeah, everybody was saying I wasn't in the tournament last year, but I did. I fished last year.
We got pictures.
It was like a couple years before. I've only not done one, and it was the year that I put out the tour video, and I was broke as fuck. I mean, I didn't have money to
I remember this because I was even like, dude, you should fish, man.
You won the croaker, and the next year you didn't fish, and last year you did fish a croaker because you took second.
No, that was the year before. Last.
Oh, really?
Is the croaker spot. Okay. Last year, we went over to Eastern Shore and just
caught. We didn't get to fish hardly at all last year.
Yeah, and that's when we went over to hang out with you that day.
Yeah, we went out and fished. Yeah.
So I did fish last year. Yeah. I paid for this year, but I didn't fish. I didn't fish at all today. I worked on the trailer.
Okay, more important. Pairs on the water.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there you go.
Nice segue. I mean, if I'm going to sit here and listen to all this crap, I'm going to get some plugs in. Hell no. I woke up at 8:20.
That doesn't mean you can't go fishing.
Yeah, tomorrow too, right?
I can't. I have to work tomorrow, but Kevin will not be. He will not be awake at 7 o'clock, ready to paddle to.
No, anywhere. I'll be waking up at 7.
Yeah, I'll be waking up at 7.
I'll be launching around between 9 and 10. As long as I'm at the beach before 10, the parking's not so bad. That's the only reason I'm.
That's the only reason he doesn't care about anything besides parking.
Nah, that's it.
Well, you were saying it's tournament day. Dude went to go ran errands, did his trailer. You went to the bank.
Yeah, I had to go to the bank today.
All the other stuff.
Yeah. All right, here's on the water before we take a break.
So you guys are like a bunch of hens just yakking back and forth.
Have you watched the show?
I've been asleep for so long, you know? It's all good, buddy. It's all good.
You get fishing stuff involved.
I do. It's all
happening.
But anyways, if anybody's interested in Heroes on the Water, they want to be a volunteer, they want, you know, just contact us, you know, tywater@heroesonthewater.org. That's tywater@heroesonthewater.org. And then also,
And the website is heroesonthewater.org.
Easier than that.
Yeah, and heroesonthewater.org, it'll have links to all of our chapters, all 30 chapters throughout the country. But like I said, the volunteers contact us directly for our chapter. And then if there's veterans in the area or veterans' family or physical therapists that know some vets or contacts over some of the bases and installations around the area, if they know some folks that really need to get out on the water, that they know they're going to benefit, because we know what the healing properties of the water and the nature, being out in nature, is. I mean, we feel it every single time that we're out there.
Mm-hmm.
Rob felt it when the lightning was coming down when he was out there.
Oh, that was therapeutic. That
was some serious movement that day, wasn't there?
Therapeutic afterwards.
But anyways, if somebody really wants to get out, contact us. We'll put them on our email list, and that way when we have upcoming events, we can contact them, just send out something and say, hey, we're having an event this day, and then they can sign up for it. Or they might not like crowds, they might not be around during our regular events. Contact us and say, hey, I'd really like to get out next Thursday. You have anybody that can take me out next Thursday? We've got a group of handpicked volunteers, people that have been around us for a while. It's not our new guys that are coming in. We want them to be around and get the gist of how we operate when we're on the water and preparing and how we're dealing with the veterans and everything. We'll team them up and meet after work or whatever. We've had trips come out of Hampton, out of Virginia Beach, Norfolk, And it's cool.
The website's not just a place where you can go and find out about stuff. It's an actual network. You can network and find, get a hold of the volunteers.
As far as from a volunteer standpoint, you can just be on the volunteer list and you get email blasts. And you know, if it doesn't work out timing for you this time, there's going to be a slew of other ones, and you can pick and choose which ones works for you to help out.
Because you guys do them all the time. You guys do the weekend stuff all the time.
Exactly.
It's almost seems like every weekend or at least every other weekend.
But we're filling a void because some of the vets that just can't get out when we go out, or they don't want to be around, you know, 20 other people. Maybe they just want to be around three people or something. We'll team them up with one of our volunteers or two of our volunteers to hit the water, you know, and you know, you want to fish saltwater, you want to fish fresh water, what do you want to do? And we'll try to team them up with those people just to get them out on a small one-on-one or you know, a couple people, you know, for safety purposes. And it'll be just a short trip and get your sea legs a little bit.
And it's unbelievable how much, it'll just a small trip, just getting these guys out and getting them on the water, just getting them out of where they hang out, where they are all day long, just getting them out is so therapeutic for them.
Right. And you know, and like I said, many of our volunteers are veterans themselves, so they know what you know, those people that were taken out, what they're going through. We've had some of our volunteers come up and say, hey, you know what, I wish Heroes on the Water and organizations like that were around when I first got out of the military, because you know, they'll say, I have PTSD and this has helped me so much. I had a vet volunteer just last night. He came up to me and he says, you know, my life is going just right, and it's because of that right there. And he pointed at the Heroes on the Water thing, and it was somebody that we all know very well. We all know him. And it's a moving testament to what volunteers are doing. Like I said, everything that we do at Heroes on the Water at the chapter level is 100% volunteer.
Yeah.
Nobody's paid.
Yeah.
So when somebody gives $10 or whatever they're going to give, it goes right to, you know, providing for the food, providing for the bait and tackle, and you know, gear and kayaks and the trailer and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And getting people on.
And plus, like this tournament, I mean, this is a huge fundraiser for the charity.
This is absolutely huge.
Yeah.
This is actually the second year that our chapter has directly benefited from it. When it was first established, you know, we had a small chapter. We didn't have a lot of needs and everything. So, you know, I said, when I first took over the chapter, I said, we don't need any money, send it to the national. Now the national says, you raise money in your local, you use it in your local, and we're finding new ways.
Yeah.
We're finding new,
yeah,
but
also,
we didn't really feel like we needed it at
this,
the time.
This area, I imagine the growth, as soon as the word got out, I imagine the growth was enormous in this area.
Especially here.
Yeah, this year, and talk about growth, this year we've actually expanded our leadership group. So we started a veteran outreach group that we made it up of veterans themselves from all branches of service. And so they're spearheading, they're going out to their bases and the people that they know that are still in the military and trying to get the word out at those installations. And then because of that, we've also had to grow our leadership because we need to have people doing certain things.
Yeah.
Like I said, we're not paid. In any shape or form, everything is done from the heart, and everything is done through volunteers.
Yeah, and it's awesome because it's growing. Everybody really cares about it.
Yeah, this year we started our first overnight trips. We went out of town. We went to Briary Creek.
Nice.
Bob and Katie Bernoski with
camping out and everything.
Power Team Lures. They said, come to our house. We camped out on floors and stuff like that. We
got a nice place there too.
Yeah, we fished Briary Creek. They cooked for us the entire time. Of course, all the guys chipped in and cooked. But Heroes on the Water paid for all the, you know, our chapter paid for all the food and everything. And we fished Briary Creek, and then we fished another little small body of water right there near their house.
Kate and Bob, it was awesome.
Yeah, they really are.
But that's like the type of things that you guys are shooting to do.
We're going to expand greatly on our overnights and our multi-day things next year. We've got the people in the leadership now that can take on some of those roles and responsibilities. Before, you know, it was just a couple of us.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Kind of burned out. But
that's what I see. You have to have that breakup of.
Yeah.
It gets that big, you have to.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
You can't do it all yourself.
No, you can't. No. Other things you're doing too. So. My neighbors mowed my lawn 3 times. So. God bless me. Sucker.
All right, cool.
God, we're parking the car behind the house.
That's right.
Thank you, Tom Vanderheiden.
Yeah, Vanderheiden over there.
Vanderheiden.
Otherwise, AKA Wayne Bradley, right?
Yeah.
Wayne, one of those guys.
Hey, before we go, Tommy.
That's right.
Yeah.
That'll be the picture for this podcast. Yeah. And we should take this section, at least, if not the whole podcast, you should cut this section and just for their website.
Oh, yeah.
It's literally a commercial for their website. Yeah. So
literally.
Yeah. I'll cut this one section and give it to you.
Awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
Ready?
Yeah.
Ready?
All right.
All right, guys. Thanks.
Yeah, cool.
Appreciate
you. Thanks. Yeah, man.
All right, guys, live. We'll be right back with somebody.
Yeah.
You'll be staring at it. We've done that. Do you see like the first one we did? We're just staring at the camera. I'm staring at watching ourselves on here. Yeah. All right, we got John Toast Oast. And what's your name again?
John Blair.
And Toast website is fishyacker.com, and do all kinds of web series stuff. But first, I want to tell everybody we're on Johnson Outdoors Pro Staff. We've been on for a long time. Damn it. Okay, it's on. Good. but we know each other from skateboarding days. That's what's funny, because when the Pro Staff was first starting to happen, I Greg was like, yeah, and then John Oast is on the team too, and I was like, that sounds familiar. And then I found you on the Williamsburg website, the Williamsburg kayak fishing organization or website. And then I went to him. I was like, that's got to be the same dude. So then I kind of, contacted him. He was like, are you the guy at Portsmouth kid that fucking had the ramp? The sick ass, sick scary. I was telling Lee about it.
It's
like 8 foot wide and 11 foot high and 3 foot avert. And I was scared to death on that ramp, man. And you were, you were ripping it. It was your backyard ramp. So that was, that's how I know you. So it was funny reconnecting to you again with through kayak fishing. And here we are again working together and doing all that stuff. So we've been on the Pro Staff for, as long as
10 years, right? Yeah. Yeah, and then your mother, of course, I'm a career law enforcement officer. And
That's right.
You know, you've known your mom because I was doing some like volunteer auxiliary type of work.
Yeah, my mom was retired a police in James City County. Newport News, and that's where you were living here. So you knew my mom through that. So that was kind of cool.
Yeah, we go way back. It's just all kind of came full circle, and that's cool.
Evan, is your buddy you fish with up in now you're living in Pennsylvania?
I'm in Pennsylvania. I've been there for 5 years. I was born and raised in Portsmouth, Virginia. Lived in Williamsburg for about 10 years. Worked in Richmond, commuting back and forth. My wife was in grad school. She was hired as a professor up in Bloomsburg, which moved us kind of the frozen tundra. Once we got there.
Well, it's funny, so he moves up there, right? He moves up there, and now he's in the north, Lee. Now he's in the north. So we go to the next demo or whatever. He was coming down for the demo, all the way down here, and he was like, man, there's no chicken up there. There's like no chicken, there's no, what was that other stuff? Was like, what was the other
one? No chicken, no pork.
No pork, no,
just fried.
Nothing fried. It was like a complete different food up there.
It's all like pierogies and Polish foods.
Pierogies.
Come on, man.
Oh, man, I haven't had a pierogi in Pennsylvania.
Come up near me, man.
Yeah. So you went from being saltwater down here to exclusively river fishing on the Susquehanna for the most part. I mean, that was your main river, but I'm sure you fish other areas. But that is your main river there. Now, you've also got a website, a community there, Pennsylvania Kayak Fishing.
Pennsylvania Kayak Fishing Association, PKFA.org, which is how I bumped into John Blair here. So we fish together, most every weekend somewhere between Harrisburg and Scranton.
All over. The railroad's all up in that area. We have lots of yards up that way.
All over. They follow the whole river up. The old canal banks are now the railroads and the railroad museum in Scranton and all that.
Well, what, the railroad station there in Harrisburg, that was on Hitler's top 10 bombing list in World War II.
Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Man, we're going to take that place out. Let's take that place out. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we want to do Hitler any favors, though, but...
been a little times. ISIS cell. And see, what's funny is I haven't been really up on all that stuff, right? So it's just all I listen to is podcasts by comedians or MMA stuff. So the comedians on there, all they do is joke. So all my information comes from comedians doing jokes about what's going on in the news.
You go backwards, you get it reversed.
Right.
So all your eyes is
probably actually more true than the news.
It was.
Yeah.
No shit.
You're probably getting better information.
So you guys fish today? What area did you fish?
We fished the other side of the HRBT.
Okay.
Pretty good. That's a pretty good spot for the wind, and I'm trying to burn a spot. But,
yeah. Well, I've been yeah. talking. I've since I'm working in Hampton now. I've fished there a couple times coming back.
It's a different style of fishing on that side of the bridge, but it's a little bit more secluded. And I bring my daughters most every year. I got one of them with me, so it's a lot easier.
One thing about I like that about here is that you don't hear the traffic. Like if you're on an Norfolk side, it's just the noisiest place in the world.
Yeah.
But over there on the Hampton side, you're actually fishing the tunnel and the island, so it's quiet, a little more quiet over there.
It's totally different. It's a different place, and you catch all sorts of different species. They're typically smaller, but you never really know.
What'd you do today?
Exactly. Got into a whole school of ribbon fish.
No, man. When those things show up, you can't catch anything but them.
Yeah, and sea bass. Yeah, bass.
Sea bass. Thousands of sea bass. Maybe like all under 8 inches.
Yeah. My daughter got the 4-inch. Spot, yeah, was,
yeah,
yeah, and then that thing put it down.
You flounder, yeah. And what's weird is I went out last Sunday and didn't catch any crooked spot, and that's what I was targeting. But I caught one flounder, one big flounder, and that was like it all day. How'd you do that?
I had an 18-inch flounder,
nice.
A ton of sea bass, and I was live lining some grunts, hoping to catch a shark. But I guess down that side of the bridge is not the best place to try to find sharks, so. Kind of let them go.
Sharks, they've been around the island.
Yeah.
Going on what we've been doing this week with fishing around the island. Yeah. I forgot to talk about this, is I saw it on video, and I had a bite off that was past my swivel on my first, actually I got my hook, about that
the
far.
Hook up. The big hook up.
Yes, it was bow, 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 and broke before I even got out of the rod holder. So it was here's the hook, and I got that much leader to a swivel, and he bit it off here.
Nice.
So it was, and it was a croaker like this. So
that's
like,
a nice one.
It didn't even have I didn't even bow up. It just went bup, bup, and it was gone.
That's crazy how it happens. Sometimes, like, I think what happens is you have the larger bait you use for the sharks, and when the smaller sharks come, they bite and they chew until they find the hook.
Yeah.
So that's the play in the rod, you know. But it's one shark we were hooking up with in the Outer Banks. It's like you said, every time this thing would come by, the rod would just. You couldn't even, you didn't have time to get out of the rod holder, just insta snap off.
Yeah.
So we think it was
big. Also, is the bait freaking out? Think about that. Bait's down there just chilling, and he's alive, and he's stuck. And all of a sudden, he sees the predator that he's supposed to run for, and he can't go anywhere because he's pinned to the bottom of the weight. And that's it's panic. Oh, my son's real calm.
Oh, man.
Yeah, well, that's cool. How much freshwater salt did you get to do?
Not too much. I went by the Susquehanna River in the freshwater.
Yeah, but
I really
do you come
like
out
to catch the sharks. Yeah, I go down to the Outer Banks, Emerald Isle area.
Oh, yeah.
I go down there maybe once or twice, maybe three times a year.
They get some big sharks down there.
I got this addiction where, like, every time I hit the salt water, I can't really try to fish for anything else but the sharks because I know it's so easy.
Well,
it's so
big.
I got to get off the sharks.
Yeah, you do. You need to catch some other fish. You need to catch some fish that actually going to fight you well instead of this retarded shark fights. Sharks are retarded.
They fight,
just like cobia sometimes. I mean, you've caught them before, but have you caught them on a kayak before?
No.
Okay,
no,
that's what sucks.
I
because
mean, small
you,
ones, nothing big.
But
though.
You hook a red and it's fight, and get him a fight, and get him an exit boat. But he's not done. You can tell he's not done because he's still kind of fighting. Mm-hmm. Sharks, you get him up inside the boat and you think he's done, and you go to start
lay on his
with
side,
him. Lay on his side like he's dead, and all of a sudden he explodes with every bit of power like you just hooked him up.
Mm-hmm.
That's the issue I have with sharks. You never can tell. You never can kind of know the deal with them. Like, if they're not hands, if I can't grab them around the back of their head, I'm cutting. I'm like, not even dealing with them. Even the little ones will get out in your boat and...
I don't know how I feel about pulling a big mouth like that into the boat either, especially while there's all the energy, it can flop around and you got lines everywhere. So maybe if I'll do a real big...
Have you watched Rob Troy's?
Maybe beside the boat. Yeah, I see a lot of this. That is
did you watch his shark video?
Yeah, awesome.
Tail wrapping, that thing still almost took him under.
That thing still wasn't even close to the size of the one Zach hooked.
Right. No, that was a 9-footer.
Yeah,
that was a 9-footer Zach hooked. I saw like a 13-footer. I don't know what. I saw a sea monster that was ever big as my Trident. Made me sit down. Scared. Like, oh, like not like wow, that's a big shark. Like, oh no.
White shark, man, they've been known to cruise into that area and they can go wherever they want.
But
man.
Not that
white shark.
But not that time of year. Those usually you see those tag sharks that move that the Chris Fisher tags. Those always seem to move through in the wintertime up here, and then they go down south. And but it seems like they always kind of hit here in the wintertime. Like that one came through and went in Oregon Inlet. Was it Oregon Inlet?
Yeah, and they came inside the Third Island, like
inside
basically
third
wrapped
island.
Around the Third Island.
And
that was like a
and
cavern. That's like a 14-foot.
Yeah, it's all about cavern. There's Misha Love who's around there too.
Yeah. And then Assateague, get like in the surf at Assateague. I mean, it was so when you go in on that map, it was actually on land. That's how close to shore it was on. You know, Google Maps showing it off, but it was on land. You know, it was.
I got a good question. Now you can go to the apps like the Shark Tracker, the apps and all that stuff, and there's all the tag sharks you see now. For the big sharks, like the monsters, the great whites, and the tigers, in the areas where there is a tag big shark, how many more of those big sharks do you think are there that are untagged?
Big ones, aren't they mainly solo sharks?
Solitary,
solo,
yeah.
And they
I don't know about sharks.
Yeah. But, I mean, for every one that they've got tagged, probably hundreds and hundreds of others that are not. You
right.
know what I mean? For every one that swims through here, for every one you see with a tag swim through here, probably thousands. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's just that many sharks. I mean, literally, there's that many sharks. You can go to the beach in the summer and put a piece of cut bait on your line and catch a shark every cast for all day long until you're tired of it. Black tips, sharp noses.
Small ones and stuff, but you can't,
small ones, and occasionally you
can
get 6-7-foot, 8-foot sand tigers, you know.
Lemon shark.
Oh, we don't get very many lemons up here.
Yeah, so you need to come down. One, you need to come down and catch a red.
Yeah.
If are you here tomorrow? Or are you guys going back?
Oh, I was thinking about staying here.
Okay.
Depends on what kind of stuff's going down.
Yeah,
so
I gotta work.
So you're down here by yourself?
Yeah.
All right. Well, how good of a paddler are you?
I'm good.
First island.
I'll make it.
You know, first island.
You've never done that though.
It's cross current.
It.
It's gonna be nice.
It's gonna be nice. If he commits,
how old are you?
27.
Oh, you're a young buck.
He can be
strong.
Strong. Tell me that one. Yeah. 21.
Like, initiate.
I'll go. Just straight paddling for a while.
It's three miles out.
Against the
three,
wind.
Three miles out. Cross current. No matter what the current's going to do, it's going to cross current.
Okay.
Yeah. We got pylons to go behind, but yeah, I'll keep you right. Yeah. What are you riding?
Awesome. Predator. Predator 13.
Oh God.
It's a big windy block. That's a sailboat.
I got mine. Trident
out. I got mine too. I'm going to turn them on that if you want to.
Trident's
easy. I'll get you out in there because you're here in a fresh.
If you're going to be down here,
if you're going to fish tomorrow, you need to go out and get a shot at a red or at least be able to see one.
Yeah. I'm down with that.
Yeah. You going
maybe
back?
We can get that same picture of that big tail. That'd be awesome.
I like those pictures now. I'm going to start doing those.
Those are good.
You know, I did. I was like, because I've always, the picture's. You know, fish are pretty, but really, those reds are, it's about those tails. You know, it's really about the different shapes of them. And it was cool that it also brought up the point to the guy who was in Louisiana. It was like, those look like, is the kids division?
No, not yet.
What were they just announced?
Striper.
Okay. Cool. None of you guys got that.
No.
Anybody we know?
Dan Smullen is in the mix, and a couple of guys.
They didn't announce winner yet.
Oh, no. This is just to take the back in.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, you just got to hang out, and then, Rob just walked in and was asking. Tosh has got to go back for his little girl who caught a pretty decent sized red, so it's probably going to win the youth.
No, it wasn't a red.
How big was it?
It was a ribbon fish.
Oh, ribbon fish.
Wow. Yeah.
You got length on
like a 5-foot long ribbon fish now.
Yeah.
Well, compared to her, it was. Ribbon fish almost pulled a rod out of her hand.
So,
I don't know. And she caught a bunch of garbage fish, and like a 3-foot ripping fish.
Nice.
Those are weird, man.
For a 9-year-old girl, that's like hardcore.
Maddox kid, Jake. He got a.
That's right. He got a
28 inch red. That's nice.
Really?
Yeah. He said he busted his rod on it too.
It's always good.
It'll be interesting.
Hey, if they
do youth, I'll come get you for sure.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks, Rob.
All right. Where were we?
Tail.
Oh yeah, the guy in Louisiana was like, those reds look different from ours, and ours are different because of their ocean runners. Okay. So their tails at 40 inches start to fork out because they're dealing with ocean currents. And the ones in Louisiana and Florida and stuff, they keep their bluntmid tails because they're not dealing with ocean currents. I mean, they're always migrating. They're, you know, swimming thousands of miles every year. So they go to an ocean current. So that's why they start to get those forked tails when they get about 36 inches, they start getting a point. And then at 40, the points get a little bit bigger and might even have a like blunt on the bottom. And then by 45,
the ones
40,
that grow
40,
really 40, big, sometimes they're like almost streamer like.
Yeah.
And then as they get older, some of them wear down.
Yeah.
But some of the ones, you know, 45 to 48 inches can have like almost streamer tails.
Yeah.
And then, you know, like I said, once the fish gets older, it becomes obvious. I mean, some of them, the tails start to rot back away. And
some of them, you notice
things are just hideously.
There was
old.
Two pictures on that my first day, or first and second, first day that
the second day when I came out there, we had one.
We had okay, so it was one on both days that I cut. I cropped the tail off because it was just gnarled.
Yeah, just
I mean, there
bad.
Was just it was a bone and like pieces of it. It was just gnarled up, you know.
Man.
Yeah.
And it's just old, man.
Well, the scale I got off of that 148, it looked in the 20s. I mean, 25, 30 years old. It was in that, just counting rings. You know, not non-scientific examination of it. It just, it looks about 20. So, yeah. So, yeah. But, yeah. You need that.
Awesome.
This will cure you of the shark crap.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand it because you know you don't get to come around the salt water that much, and it's
just
a glamorous thing.
Even a 28-inch redfish would end it.
Yeah. I like the prehistoric animals. There's still few prehistoric animals left on the earth.
Would you hold this red in your lap? Just look at his face, man. These things are amazing.
And they've been around a long time.
Yeah.
Too.
Their face, they're just missile-like. When you release them, you hold them in the water by their mouth, and just they're missile-like. You know, their head just sharp. Sharp noses for rooting. They're just mean, man. They're tough looking
bull.
Fish. Yeah, they're tough looking fish, and you're
smart fight. You're not used. It's like the redfish. You know, you just turn
and
yeah. The fight's different.
And the thing is also deep water. We're catching them in 30 or 50 foot of water. So it's down and running and turn on you. And
that's awesome.
What kind of rod do you have?
Oh, I got a bunch of ugly sticks. I got Penn Prevail, got 8 foot Penn Prevail, and I have a custom ugly stick. It's
what weight,
real
weights
heavy.
Are these?
Oh, the ones heavy, medium, heavy.
Yeah, like
heavy.
A boat rod style?
Yeah, they're big. I have some big rods on it.
You should have seen that little rod we
got the whole range, so.
Did you watch
Miracle?
Yeah, he caught a. Yeah, he could. They caught a big
goby. Miracle. 80 pounds. That was a giant.
80 pound cobia.
Last Friday.
Yeah, last week.
Last Friday.
Yep.
Holy cow.
Right,
where you guys are. Right where you're drum fishing.
Yeah, where we're
drum fishing. I went. We were trying. We went cobia fishing all day. I didn't see a single thing. Went back into the bridge and set up to drum fish to save the day for the guy's neighbors who, you know, we were basically like just trying to help them catch their first big fish. And we didn't get a drum bite. We got one bite and it was an 80 pound cobia on a cut bait on the bottom. It was awesome. Awesome.
The spin rod?
No.
No, it's bait. Okay.
310 GTI.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
10 pounds of drag on that thing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I had it cinched all the way down. I mean, the fish was so heavy, you could, like, just pull up, and the line just came off the reel.
Yeah.
It was like, when you pull them up, you had to put your thumb on the spool to get the fish to come up. It was awesome.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
Holy cow.
That's what we have in the bay.
Yeah. This thing decides to take off, it's just like, all right.
Yeah, Red's going to do
watch
that
the reel and wait. Wait for him to slow down.
Holy cow.
Yeah, Red's going to do that to you, too.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yep. Damn, too bad you gotta go back.
Yeah.
Were you riding a Predator 2 up here? Is that what you
brought? I just brought the tandem this time.
Oh, okay, yeah, let's try Union Gear.
Oh,
yeah.
So we're gonna, that's a lot of fun at the
What tandem?
The Malibu 2XO.
Oh, okay.
So it's mainly smallies that you're targeting now?
We're mostly targeting smallies and muskies.
Muskies.
So you need to come there for a muskie.
Yeah. Yeah.
Those are fun.
Yeah.
You call muskies?
I just got mine on
Friday.
He got
his first big one the other day.
How big?
From PA, about 40 inches.
Okay. So that's like what, 15, 16 pounds?
It wasn't too
bad.
I mean, they're not that heavy, really.
Once they get like 5, 6 inches, they get start to get, you see them start to barrel out.
The big thing with them is just making sure you can hook them, get a hook set in them before they bite you off.
Yeah, so how do you deal with that in the kayak? Do you do net or do you just boker grip size?
Boker grip and yank them.
Yeah.
So what kind of are you doing? Treble hooks?
I mean, I try the treble hooks. I was using a flat stick. You know what the flat stick is? It's, is it made by Storm, this brand called Storm,
a flat stick.
It's like a big jerk bait. It looks like a Rapala, has a pretty big lip, but instead of being rounded, it's squared on the side, so it has a really good action.
Yeah.
But what's cool is it has a really sinister rattle on the inside of it. So as opposed to like the average rattle trap where it's always a constant rattle, this is just like a like the whole way through the water. So it's just, you can hear it while you can feel it while you're reeling it in. So
yeah. Just like big saltwater baits.
Yeah.
It's just big action and big sound and
vibration and stuff.
And you get them, like, you get a lot more followers than you do whites.
Oh yeah. They see it once and they're gone. They're easy to spook.
Yep. You want to get them on the right day too, because certain days, I mean, they'll be laying right by the bank, you know, and if they're not gonna eat, they'll see you and they won't move. And you can cast everything you want at them.
You
for
stare at you
all
laughing.
Year, and they're not gonna do anything. They'll just swim away. But if you go out on that one day. And you will see them.
You can
see them darting around.
You got any spot up there? Throw an eel or a spot in front of them. I bet you'll get a different reaction.
You'll get a different reaction.
There used to be a lot of eels in the Susquehanna. It was a commercial fishery.
Man, get you a couple of them. Keep them alive. Take them up there. I bet. Get you. Oh boy. That one won't eat.
There's some striper techniques out there for muskies, man. All of a sudden, all of Pennsylvania on the river is like live, line, and stuff.
Nothing is turning down a worm like that.
Yeah, I'm drinking a blue crab for muskies.
Your crab hits the water and goes like, what the fuck is this? Freezing ass water. Hibernation. Closes up, sinks to the bottom. So when they're like chilling, you have to make them bite. But when they're darting around, they're active. They're chasing, they're eating
all kinds of stuff.
And they'll school up and channel mouth. They're kind of easier to find too. Like in low water and high water, they're all. You're always gonna be around the mouth of the creek.
Schooling up, like how big a school is? Are you talking about like 40-inch muskies?
Damn.
So you're like seeing them. Is it shallow water?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
So like cruisers, like reds.
You'll see them. If you're up on a bluff or something, you look down, you'll see like a whole school of them down there. And you throw at them all day long, and they totally ignore you.
Mm-hmm. One thing I saw for the first time just on Friday, really sweet. While these muskies were darting all around and eating, they were actually traveling in formation until they decided to strike. And then once they found something they were going to strike on, they would split up at the same time and strike.
Yeah.
So they dart all around the creek in formations like a pod of dolphins swimming around, like super fast. If you blink, you miss it. But you can see them in the wake and everything, and then you get close, you can see they're in formation, and they'll just split and eat. And it'll come
sounds
back.
Like Kobe dude, to me.
Isn't that so badass that you saw that? Because in that, just seeing that, you learned so much from that.
Yeah.
I mean, because I can do the same thing with reds.
It's a smart fish.
Yeah, exactly. See, you went from, and that's, man, and that's the thing. It's just like we were talking about my hippie voodoo shit the other day. It's not only, you know, you just advanced over a lot of anglers because you don't see that fish as a fish. You see it as a beam.
Yeah.
You see it as a thinking being with tactics and it strikes. And you saw how that happened. And that's part of the hippie voodoo shit.
And they cooperate.
You saw it and you got so now you got that in mind.
Yeah.
Now you just saw them reacting. So you have a little bit more respect. It's a respect thing, it's a learning from them thing. You kinda see their tactics. You kinda got an idea of what in their heads. That's where you jump as a fisherman. That's
3 years of trying to get the same fish. It took some dedication. I forced myself to fish on days where the conditions were like awesome, you know, and I gotta go to work in 2 hours. I'm really beat, you know. And I have to go put all my gear together. I just want to lay in bed and watch TV until I go to work. But the conditions are too good, and I know this fish are out there, so forced myself to go out there. You know what? Still don't get any bites. And it's like that for 3 years.
But now, this thing, now you will. Now you've learned them. It took us 3 years to figure out the sight cast on Nisha Shore. Three fucking years, man. It was a long time of going over there, and finally, connect the dots. Oh, now we got it. Yeah. And it took us a couple more years to really dial it in, and that's where you're at, man.
For a while, we were just casting it mud.
Yeah.
Blind casting.
Yeah. And now we hunt. It's just a full-on hunt. And what's cool is more fun at that level too.
Yeah.
Because you're practicing an act. You're practicing something that you've done, and it's really cool.
Yeah,
it's,
you're not just going out there and taking a chance.
Yeah, and it's not fishing. You're working something. You're doing. It's a whole nother level, man.
Yep.
How long have you been fishing?
My whole life since I've been a little kid. My grandpa raised me fishing. Probably for about 10 and 12 years
now. Oh, cool.
No real good kayaks when I started. I didn't get any real nice
but
kayaks
been,
so I met John.
You've been on that river. That's your backyard.
Canoes also when I was little. Got on the canoe by myself, so.
What's cool is it sounds like you're about ready to like advance into that next level. You know what I mean? You've really,
I'm ready. He's becoming a student.
I'm a
fisherman, but a student.
Exactly.
I'm ready to be ready.
Yep.
Yeah.
And it's cool because it's fun. It's a lot of fun, you know.
Yeah.
Well, there's a saying that it's good when you're lucky. It's I forgot what it is. I'm gonna butcher it, but it's probably somebody will look it up. But it's like it's something that's like it's good when you're lucky. It's fun when you're good, but it's like badass when you're really good or some shit. You know, it's there's different levels. It's like really fun when you're out there just catching fish, but when you are doing, you got a target and you want to do it that way. It's like back to five levels of fishing. First, you want to catch anything. Next, you want to.
I read I heard it was three. There was anything you can catch, then the biggest thing you can catch, and then what you want to catch whenever you want to catch
That's it. For saltwater, it's a different level. It's basically the same thing. It's exactly the same thing. Yeah.
Awesome. I mean, it'll freak out because, you know, I fished, you know, forever. So we'll go up there. I'm like, oh, I'm going to throw this on. I'm going to catch a catfish. I'm going to catch a muskie.
He calls it every time.
It's like freaking bait. I'm going
to go. Same bait. Wait till you change baits.
It's like, says, oh my God, nobody's going to do it.
Wait till you hook, hook a fish.
Big old catfish.
Wait till you hook a fish and immediately, oh, that's this size.
You know how
this.
It's fighting you.
This
you
size, know. This.
Yeah.
For the first, oh, that's this. Yeah. But yeah,
it comes. Yeah. You just gotta, like you're saying, you gotta study it and become a student of it, you know? Mm-hmm. And then you know exactly the techniques you're gonna look at where you're fishing. Even if somewhere new, like a couple of times you've done it, new places we're getting to. I'm like, I know what to throw in, I know where to throw it, and it looks right. And you know what's gonna work.
Yeah.
Yeah, fishing is so fucking cool.
Yes. It's like I was telling all the guys beside me out there. Just sitting behind me or
something.
Dan? Yeah, the other guy, the right of me.
Rick, Tom.
Tom.
Yeah, he's over Tom Hipple.
I was telling Tom, man. I totally lost my train of thought.
That's all good. We do
that.
Yeah. Did you ever watch his podcast?
I just had Vanderhyden in here, and we just started going like that, and he was like, what is this, like chickens? I said, have you ever watched this?
He's like, yeah, I went to sleep. But yeah, totally lost it there. What were you just saying before? Student?
Trout division.
The what?
Trying to listen outside, see what that was.
Which one is it, trout?
Trout, I believe.
Oh yeah, calling for a size, like different card still.
Did you say you had one?
They already pulled into my daughter. No. They already called her in.
Okay.
Oh.
And
oh,
I called her in to look at her card. So.
Nice.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I'll remember sometime. I'm sure I'll let you know. Remember that day like 3 months ago? Like, I remember what it was.
Right.
Send you a personal message or something. It'd be totally weird and random. Yeah, you'd be like, who is you? Man. Awesome.
Yeah, you're just doing a travel. I'm sorry, I'm getting distracted because I'm trying to listen outside, but yeah. I might as well close it up.
Yeah, good.
And he can, awesome. I mean, you know, when I come down here, I got a place to stay all the time.
Yeah.
So, and he's, you know, these guys can say, you can usually bring somebody with me if you RSVP too late.
Yeah.
So he's in a hotel by himself.
Yeah.
It's probably
the red roof
anyway,
in. Red roof in. The bathtub doesn't even work. $90 a night and it doesn't even hold water. I tried to take a bath last night.
Don't take a bath in the hotel bathroom.
Yeah, like,
I need to be in the water, man. I can't. I'm too lazy to stand in the water. I need to lay in the water.
Do you have one of them old style, like on the feet bathtubs in the country and shit?
Right in the middle of the room.
Pennsylvania, man.
Right in the middle of the room. Read a newspaper and have a woman shave me while I'm sitting in the bathtub.
Got a fire underneath them and warming up. Shit. Yeah, you know,
I was sitting there for 6 hours.
Amish.
Read a book. Yeah. I get wrinkly and I'm like, oh man, the water's cold. Time to dump it out and put more water in. Put more hot water in, dude. I'm here for another 4 hours. Yeah. Pretty much stay in the water.
Awesome.
All right.
Good.
Yeah. All right.
Here we go.
All right, guys. We'll be right back.
Yep.
Hey, guys.
awesome. Funny.
Sleepy. Don't want that. Awesome, man.
All righty. Probably last one we're going to do tonight. Starting to wrap up out there. And already got two of the winners in here. And they're starting to do... you're doing the raffles now and starting to get to the end of the night out there. So this is probably the last one we're going to do. But this is a good one because we've got Dan Smullen. And he's from Yak Attack. And we also have Luther from Yak Attack. And Rob Troy, of course.
Yeah.
And
that's
AnglingAddict.com. And of course, Yak Attack at YakAttack.us. And you just won the first place Striper Division.
I did.
Yeah, with a
24 and a quarter.
Yeah.
It's fourth, fifth tournament, I think. It's finally nice to have something to weigh in at the end of the day.
That's right. Yeah, definitely.
Where did you go? This side of the water, in the region? You know, know exact places.
The Elizabeth region. River.
Okay, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
This side, south side. Matt Anderson and I, we fished there a lot, so we like to think we have some local knowledge. It wasn't on quite as much as it has been in the past today, but we still took Luther out there. He stuck with us.
Tag along.
Mm-hmm.
No big striper for me.
Yeah, but you, first thing in the morning, I look at, because I woke up late, and then, you know, and I look at the post on Facebook, and you got like an 18-inch, I'm like, damn, he's already, this is what you got to be today, you know, that type of thing.
It started pretty good, man. I mean, you know, couple of years out here, I had almost a slam, missing the spec. Started off with a spec. I was pretty happy with it. Yeah. 17 and a half, but I was pretty happy.
Yeah.
It was good.
Yeah.
It was fun.
Well, that's what I'm saying. When I first thing I see you posted, I was like, man, now anybody's looking at this, it's a good spec today. This is kind of what you got to beat at this
set
point.
The bar.
Yeah, exactly. Early in the morning.
Set the bar pretty low, but it was set.
No, it's decent for this time of year. I mean, yeah, right. Granted, the spec should be moving with all these cold fronts we've been having. We've had an early fall. It should be moving through here through the south side. But that's still pretty good starting off. I mean, yeah. But granted, we got also the spec masters out there took the top three, right?
It's almost like when they're not placing, you're like, man, that's weird.
Yeah. I mean, something's wrong with the fish.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
And then were you, Rob, you won the
second place in Reds. Yeah. It's weird when you know, we've talked about going off the rig Reds, you know, during the tournament, and it's a lot of stuff has to line up. And I was paddling out. It was a horrible paddle out, first of all. And I kept looking back, saying, nobody's coming out here. Nobody's coming out. And then sure enough, you know, I get my red, and I turn around. As I'm releasing, I look over. It's like, oh man, there's people coming out here now. And the thing is, the Maryland guys are cool. I like them, and they're hardcore fishermen.
Oh yeah,
and I respect them, and it's. If I had to lose to somebody, at least it was people that I
well,
know.
Those guys, for me, those guys were cool because when I did the Bay Tour, when I was kind of exploring that area for fisheries, and I knew nobody fished like the Hunger River and stuff, and I got on their forum, I was like, look, you guys got to check this, and this is your area. I mean, it's kind of far for me to go fishing, but this is right in your backyard. You guys can go hit this. And they started hitting.
And Daughtry and them.
Yeah.
They started
mastering that area, and then they started coming down here and putting the work in and all that stuff. So, yeah, those guys.
And it's a long drive for them, and it's, I respect that. That's cool that they put in the time and they figured it out.
Yep. But, yeah, it's a paddle out. Today it was. Like I said,
how's the paddle back in, Rob?
I mean, I was already so sore from the morning. I mean, it was better, though. It was definitely better.
Have it at your back and you just ride it in?
It kind of pushed more from the west, almost, like, as I was coming in, and it was okay. I mean, it was choppier than I would have liked, but, you know, still definitely better than the morning. I don't know if I said it on air last time, but it was a minimum of 20 paddle strokes between piling sets.
Yeah.
And there's like hundreds of them, so it was pretty bad.
You know, when we count, that's how you count how easy your day is going to be when you actual paddle strokes, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sometimes when it's fast, it's in the 12.
Yeah.
And when it's a kick your ass day, it's in the 20 in that range.
Yeah. Yeah. It was about 13, 14 on the way back.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's about average. Yeah.
But it was worth it. And I don't want to sound, so basically where I was getting at earlier is that when we all said that if we ever get a chance to go after them, whoever catches it, we're going to win it.
Right.
So I was really excited and I got in line when I came back and
no, that's the thing.
The guy looks at me and was like, I got you. I was like, oh.
Because I even told you when the text car called me, I was like, you got a 48, you're good, you should be good.
Yeah.
But then you said some guys were showing up. I was like,
all right. Well, just as I was thinking, I was just going to head back and look for a slam instead. The guy that came in third, he caught his. and his was really close to me, like half an inch off, and then I was like, man, maybe I should stick around because people have been catching 50s out there, no big deal. Mm-hmm. Not no big deal, but you know, like it's
part
a lot
of the
more,
day.
Yeah,
somebody's
lot,
catching
lot more
one.
Frequent lately. Yeah. So I stuck around and I didn't catch nothing. Shane Hatcher, like I said earlier in the show, that he hooked up with three. Jay hooked up with two. One of his is 53, and nobody. It slowed down a lot, and then all of a sudden, like none of the boats were hooking up. Jay stopped hooking up, so I decided I'm just gonna try to get back in and maybe hit Lesnar, just you know, see what I can do real quick.
Yeah.
I actually did launch a Lesnar.
Did you?
I was so tired.
Short trip at Lesnar.
Yeah. And yeah, it was rushing out too, so it was, yeah. I got it to a good flounder bite yesterday, and I thought I'd go and try it again, but it was way later in the tide than it was yesterday when I went, so.
And plus trying to find a spec there, you have to battle back, and.
Yeah, it was, I don't know.
With the outgoing.
It's one of those wishing for freakish luck. It just didn't happen. But, again, I'm happy for the guy who got it, the 51 incher, to win it.
Yeah.
Always good times here.
Yep.
Yeah, they said third place, like, what, 48?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And at any given other tournament, 48 would have hands down won.
Right. But this,
every year the numbers have been cranking up at the tournament. You know, 3 years ago,
if you could even get out, it was 24. Because I've been targeting them for the last couple of years. If I could get out, I had them here. Right?
They were always talked about,
in the range. You know, they're here this time of year. It was just I haven't been able to get out.
Not only that, sometimes Sandbridge too. And it's like there's always been options.
Yes, and they've been at Sandbridge because Sandbridge Pier, they showed pictures of that yesterday. I mean, they've been on Sandbridge Pier. So they're here. This right now we're peeking out. Right now
I'm curious to see how like we've been getting more and more 50s, 50 pluses, and it makes me wonder because they're a protected species. Obviously, they're gonna just keep getting. Where's the ceiling?
I think the world record was in the 64 inch range.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a 94 pounder, but it was 64 inches is what it was.
Just that old black and white picture. See float.
That and I think the Virginia record, which was 85, is up on at Cape Charles. When you go in, there's that little restaurant right there in the corner. There's a mount of it there. And it's ridiculous. Yeah. It's a sea monster, man. It's like, well, wow. And it's on a wall far away from you. You can see how big it is. You know. I've seen pictures recently of at least 80 pounders. I mean, ones that were 60 some inches and that big around, guys holding it on like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen that recently.
Do you think it's going to become more frequent?
It's going to be
really cool to see.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep. We got sea monsters. It's awesome.
Sea monsters are good.
And then we can target off a kayak and play with them on a kayak. It's the best fish, man. It's the best thing. You guys staying tomorrow?
Probably gonna roll out pretty early. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe try to hit some water on the way home or something.
Not me, man.
No, I'm heading back tonight.
Nah.
Back in family mode tomorrow. And
yeah.
Back to work on Monday.
Yep.
Yeah. Nice. You know, we do all kinds of stuff. It's all Yak Attack, but it's not in any kind of kayak fishing mode at work. It's just work.
Yeah.
Programs this and. Production that and
well, if you sat around and talk about fishing on day one, get the badass stuff and produce out.
We get everything done.
Yeah, but, there's two arts going on here. You know, they're really completely different. Really.
Yeah,
but it's cool to come down here. get your feet wet for a day or so.
Well, it was fun. We were talking about guys have been wanting to fish with it because you're not only are you the head of the creator of Yak Attack, but you fish a lot too. So guys see it and they're like. You know, your fame. You have your fame from what you do and what you produce. But also, you guys are starting to see it and starting to want to fish.
It's funny when I see that. I'm like, they want somebody easy to meet. That's always true. Yeah. I mean, it's fun, man. Fishing's always been a enjoyable pleasure thing for me. My work has always been really intense and stressful, and I've never connected the dots. It's like a lot like when I play music. I never really got super disciplined about it. It was always just a kind of a pleasure thing. Fishing's like that for me.
Yeah.
When I get intense about something, it's really, really intense, and it's you could almost say kind of hard to have fun at it. But at the same time, I totally enjoy it. I probably enjoy working.
I think it shows that you're fishing.
So I've always kind of kept a little bit of space between the intensity and the recreation, and I love it, but try not to be too serious about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You've been supporting this tournament for a little while now, haven't you? I mean,
this tournament. The people here is. There's probably, and I couldn't name every one, but there's probably 12, 15 people here today that if it wasn't for those guys, we may have never gotten a foothold at all in this sport.
Yeah.
Just off the top of my head, I mean, John Ost out there, Wayne Bribey, it's just a handful of people. Tom Hipple, he won something tonight. I haven't heard the name in a few years, but he was one of our, I was telling Danny, he was like, I think you bought one of the first 10 busy poles. It was a group of guys that, not only saw some, utility in the product that we had at the time, but they really, I feel like, opened the door. And, I feel like when we first started, we didn't really earn a spot in the sport. Like, it was open arms, like just welcomed us into it, even before we had done anything to deserve it. And I'll never forget that. And this group here, and the same thing for the Yakutak tournaments, like this Virginia group, if it wasn't for them, I don't know if we would have ever gotten a foothold. So it's cool to come out here and be able to, you hear the term kind of give back. Yeah, I don't know, but I don't think we'd be here for these folks here. So it's cool.
Yeah.
It's a neat thing. This whole Virginia kayak fishing dynamic is pretty incredible.
You're here. You're a local guy. I mean, you're a Virginia guy, so it's not that you didn't have to earn it. You were part of the scene. That's the thing. It's not like you really had to earn your way into the whole thing. But you're already here. You're a fisherman. I mean, granted, you're not a, like you said, you don't take it super serious and it's a fun thing for, but you're still, it's a fisherman. You're a fisherman.
Yeah, sure.
You're a fisherman.
Yeah.
You target stuff and you catch them. And you're an actual fisherman. You're not a crook, not like a bottom crooker, double head squid fisherman.
Yeah, but I think it was back then.
Sorry for the stereotype or whatever. No offense. Sorry for the offense.
Yeah.
No offense.
Yeah, right.
I remember, Parcel in Heaven, we were doing the little meetings over at Crab Creek when it was a pizza shop, tackle shop thing, we were having like a rigging seminar thing, and I remember like you were just starting to come up, like just having ideas of what you wanted to actually do with the accessories, and I was, it's amazing to think now, like,
we never expected that.
That's just, it's crazy.
Dude, someone was just asking me today, been 10 years of this, this tournament and stuff, and asked me, would you ever thought back then, in the second one, which the first one I did, would it ever been this big? And I was like, no, because I had thought at that time there was going to be some kind of ceiling. I was always thought there was going to be some kind of ceiling that I was going to level off or plane off, but I didn't see to foresee the gas prices. I didn't see the climate of what's, of today, and you can see it now, the relations of gas prices and boat shit and all this other crap that, and all of a sudden you get a kayak and have the ease of it,
it's infectious. I mean, I've said it so many times, but it reminds me a lot. I started bow hunting when I was a teenager, in the early 80s or late 80s, and this is exactly the same thing. I mean, and if you look at, I look at it from a business standpoint, I look at the bow hunting market now, and I look at how big it is.
And advancements.
There's not too many people that are really serious about hunting that aren't bow hunting.
Right.
And I believe 10 years from now, there's not going to be too many people that are super serious about fishing that aren't kayak fishing.
Yeah.
They might not only kayak fish, but they're going to have a kayak in the shed or in the garage.
Got to be a part of their arsenal.
Because how can you not? How can you not? It's the ultimate. You take it to the next level and the next level.
Well, not only that, even the kayaks have influenced the boats. More guys are buying skiffs now because the kayaks have exposed the backwaters.
Yeah.
Those waters were most people here in the bay always had 24-foot, 22-foot boats. 24 boats that were bay boats that would go right out of the inlets into the bays. The guys started getting kayaks and started exploring these backwaters, and now people are getting skiffs.
Like Wes.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was talking to Wes about.
Skiff
it. Skiffs and sight casting. I mean, that was all exposed, and it's all become growing because in the boat world, powerboat world, because of kayaks.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's.
Yeah, I don't think it started really. I hear all the time, like, how long is this wave gonna last? And I don't even think it started. I think we're at 10%.
I don't think it's like a wave.
10 or 15%.
It's not even a wave at this point.
Yeah.
I would have thought it was a wave in 2006 if it dropped off at that point.
Right.
But it's
I don't think the ceiling's even viewable right now.
Right?
And it's too accessible. Yeah, it's too easy.
International tournaments, people going to, you know, yeah, flying to Amsterdam, moving boats to Europe for tournaments. It's crazy. There's that much going into it.
The thing that has repeated itself so many times is, in my own experience, is you take somebody kayak fishing once. If you take 10 people kayak fishing, probably 8 of them are hooked.
Yeah.
It's a very high hookset rate. I mean, it's incredible. You go out and you fish out of a kayak. You know, you can catch a big fish or you can catch a small fish, but it's a different experience than catching out of a boat or catching off of a pier or off the bank or whatever. And when something has that kind of intrinsic appeal, you know, that kind of resonating factor, that kind of, you know, not to get too corny, but kind of it shakes something, you know, and you're like, oh man, I got to do this again.
Yep.
You know? And it's unstoppable at that point. It's out of anybody's hands. It's just, the sport is something special all by itself without anybody, you know, having, you know, making it that. It's just, it resonates.
That's right. I remember that part of feeling that when I first started kayaking. During my first tour, I was like, because I had basically got into kayaking just a tour. So I had done 2 years. I knew during these 2 years, this is something special, man. This is something else. And then I did a tour. I was like, this is like life changing activity. This is this plastic boat and getting on the water like this will change people's lives. Yeah. I mean, it's not just a fun thing to do, but it will change your perspective on stuff. It just opens up a lot of stuff. I mean, you know.
Yeah, it's the independence aspect of it. You can go on a boat. You know, somebody's driving, somebody's got fish in the good spot on the boat, somebody's in the back, but kayaking, you can go with your friends, still have that, you know, activity with your buddies, but everybody goes, does their own thing.
You're your own captain. That was a huge thing for me.
Yeah. You put yourself on that fish, not a captain or somebody else who, you know,
And you're at eye level with the fish.
Yeah.
There's a sense of intimacy that you're never going to get any other way.
And the family aspect. I mean, you take your 10-year-old fishing on a boat, and he's along for the ride, basically. But you take your 10-year-old out on the water, and, I mean, you know, he, like Rob was saying, he's making decisions.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to go here. I'm going to try that. I'm going to, you know, what just happened there? I think at the end of the day, it's going to create a whole another class of anglers. And I think we're already starting to see it. You know,
That's a perfect example of that. Yeah. Granted, he's a little bit older. You know, you're talking about younger generation, like the kids that they're under 10 at this point, but he's still a good example. I mean, he got into this sport when it was still early and it's being a kid, you know, a little kid. So, yeah, he's a good example of that.
Absolutely.
And, yeah.
Took it to Tom's kid today. I mean, a nice 20, 28, I mean, was it 28 and a quarter, 28 and a half? Red drum.
He's catching nicer fish than Tom ever
had. And the bonding thing, too, and family and stuff. I mean, it's amazing.
Yep.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
You went out with your dad a little bit that one day in the summer. Out a little bit and you went out there with your dad.
Yeah, man.
Yep.
He was having fun on the spot.
Yep. You found a spot.
Yeah.
You ran into his favorite one little area. Yep. Boom, spot.
I put him in the Predator because he had back issues. I mean, he still does. He's not a strong paddler. He messed up his back and I think ribs a while back too. And so I was thinking of getting him that new Predator that's got the trolling motor in there. But as far as comfort, he said this is way different. It's so much better. And I'm getting out with your dad's on this.
Yeah, that's what I've been trying to do, but my dad's gotten so. My dad was a big. My dad's probably shorter than me, but in high school he was like 5'8". I'm 5'8" now, but I was 5'8" and 260.
Whoa,
straight gorilla, right? So So of course, you know, the guy's getting in the late 70s. You know, he's not taking care of us. All that shit became fat as fuck. So now he's like overweight and been trying to get him to get back in shape because I want to paddle with him. You know, I mean, he got me in the paddle sports because he got me into a canoe.
I remember seeing the picture of your dad in the canoe standing up with the
fucking badass, fucking Hercules looking motherfucker, you know what I mean? But now he's all old and lazy and sitting on the couch. I've been trying to get him out of the couch and get him in, you know, get him on the water. Yeah, but he's got a boat, but I don't like being on the boat. You know, he's got a four stroke and stinking and
can we keep that motor?
Just keep us upwind from that or somehow, but yeah. You know, but I've been wanting to get him in too because I want, you know, I wish we had these boats when we were kids.
Right, and that's the other thing that's happening is like you're talking about the seat. I mean, you know, just in 5-year span, you know, Jackson started it with the hollow seat, you know, the bench style seat, and now, I mean,
you got on these things all day long, and it doesn't matter,
back problems or not. I mean, you can find a boat that's just as comfortable as you want to be.
Yeah, and I think they're still going to work towards that seat innovation stuff, because. Yeah. New guys, I mean, look at the Feel Free, the Lure.
Yeah.
That's a ridiculously uncomfortable seat. I mean, that's probably the most comfortable seat in the market. You know, so that's going that way. It's 10 positions. And you know, everybody's doing that type of seat, and I think that's even going to change. I mean, the stuff that's happening with Wilderness now. Yeah. I mean, their seats are getting, you know,
you think the traditional, like, Surf to Summit seat, I mean, that's really the exception now, isn't it?
I still love that.
I still love it.
You know, it's all right here.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I got a Surface.
That's the thing is, real paddling seats are a minimum. Tarpon seats are probably the best paddling seats in a kayak out today.
The
right?
Old school tarpon?
No, the new ones now. The ones with you can control your legs here, you can control the back. It's all it's tight, man. It's really nice.
The thing about the high-low seats, even the low setting, in many, it's not low enough. It's for some of the things that we like to do. Like today. If I would like, the fact that I'm in the water, not like above the water, like if I was any higher than I am in my Trident, I wouldn't have gone out today.
Yeah.
Because it's, you can feel it. If it's, and sometimes I'm still tucking myself down even more.
Center of gravity matters, right?
Oh yeah. And if you're going offshore, I mean, you gotta pick the really, really good days if you got, even for the high-low seats, I'm saying. Like, so, I think there's always gonna be a need for.
Well, my issue also with the long chair seats, the high low seats, is my elbows were hitting. I'm not a big dude, you know. I mean, I have a tight paddle stroke, and my elbows would hit, so I'd have to chicken wing, and it would wear out my shoulders. So as I was adding movements because I had to dodge the seats, so I ended up using the high seats and the Predator just kind of.
And that's what drives innovation is you have.
That's right.
You have a sector of the market that says we want this. So you do that.
I mean,
and then you have another sector that says, "Yeah, but
we still
so
need,
then
still
and, need and, this." And what happens is one or two things. A lot of times it'll diverge, and you'll have two different solutions. Which is, I think that's one of the really neat things about the sport right now is it doesn't matter what you want. There's something. I mean, you're talking about the more paddling style boats. I mean, there's what, two or three brand new ones this year.
Yeah. Yeah,
correct. You know, so
I'm very curious to see
so you've got that dynamic, and at the same time you've got the comfort dynamic, because not everybody is a, you know,
and a lot of people don't care to go offshore. They
inshore,
like
you know, inshore lakes.
And even offshore. I mean, I've spent quite a bit of time offshore in those bench style seats. So maybe it's not the same. Maybe it's not as refined. Maybe it's not quite. But I think what's gonna naturally happen, what tends to naturally happen with innovation is you start to merge the needs of the different areas. You know, you start off, it's coarse, you know, brush strokes at first, and then they get finer and finer and finer. I think that's probably what we're gonna be, you know, what we're gonna be seeing in the next few years.
That's right.
The center of gravity thing, I think what you're saying there is huge. I mean, you know, I'm sitting here, you know, like there's probably a way to achieve that.
Well, like the Jackson, it's crazy how you're already brainstorming.
It's something we've been. Yeah, you know, I've had a lot of conversations about. We've talked about, but yeah, there's, you know, but it's just neat to see, like, and like you said, at first, yeah, there are pretty broad brush strokes, but that's, I mean, I really believe that 10 years from now, you know, most of us that are part of this right now are going to look back and say, wow, it was so cool. What was going on back then? Like, it was.
You know, step back,
big giant quantum leaps year after year after year. I mean, we went out to Outdoor Retail this year. There wasn't one company that came out with, you know, these big innovations. I mean, it was like five or six or something like that. And then knowing that there's a market play, like the sport is growing so much and everybody's so excited about it that it's every little crumb is going to get consumed and beg for more and demand what needs to be there next year. And the manufacturer, I mean, we're in an environment right now where everybody's listening, you know, and they're going to respond. And yeah, it's just, I can't wait to see what next 5 years brings.
It's so cool hearing that from you, because you're not only one of the inventors of this sport, of the products of this sport, but you're also tripping out on watching it all happen.
On the boat side, I mean, we're definitely spectators, you know, but even on the product side, I mean, we like to see what everybody's doing. It's just neat to see
the whole thing happen.
Yeah. And it's the feedback from the paddlers and from the anglers is, you know, it's I really believe this is different than most markets. I mean, the direct feedback, you know, we get the constant interaction all the time. I'm sure other manufacturers do. And
well, also up until this point, the internet wasn't as connected. We weren't all as connected to Facebooks and internet as much as it is now.
Yeah, very true.
And this sport has grown in advancement because of that, of the connections talking and the fishings and the forums and all that stuff. So that's all kind of come with and to advance the growth of that type of stuff. I'm sure, and even with bow hunting, I'm not a bow hunter, but I've listened to podcasts with guys talking about bow hunting, and they were talking about the same thing with their advancements in the last couple of years. And you had a bow from 10 years ago that's not even compared to what is going on today with the lightness and the torque and whatever, you know, all that stuff.
Yep.
But that's, so.
And interestingly enough, you know, and I think I really think we're probably starting to see it a little bit now. You know, with bow hunting, there was the, from the recurve to the compound to the solo cam to the, you know, super fast bow, super, and then you get this sector that of the sport that says, well, yeah, I've kind of mastered that, and they start going back to the basics and back to the fundamentals, and then it's like, oh, now there's a whole nother class of recurves, you know, there's a whole nother class of bow hunter, really, that, okay, you know, once you've mastered, you okay, so you went from hunting with a gun, now you've stepped it up, now you're hunting with a bow, well, now you've mastered that, now you step it up, now you're hunting with a recurve, then a long, you know, the long bows.
Well, it's stepping forward, but it's stepping back in the history of the sport they're doing.
Exactly, and I think we're probably going to see something similar. I think we may have started to see it a little bit already, but, you know, lighter weight boats, you know, I mean, we went wider and wider and wider. You've got to stand up. You got to, you know, and now you've got all these anglers that
they're people are trying and going, oh, well, this isn't working that well. I mean, a big wide boat isn't most proficient when they're, you know, that type of thing.
And let's say somebody bought a boat to go fish a, you know, 20-acre lake, so they were okay with, you know, oh, this is perfect. It's this big, and I can stand up, and I can do all these things. But what happens is, at the end of the day, you're paddling. You're paddling these boats, and then you start to read and you start to fish with people and, you know a little bit more about paddling.
And you're probably going, what is this hurting so goddamn bad? Because, because I'll paddle like this, that's why.
or eventually, I think you just get a appreciation for paddling.
Yeah.
You know, what you've got, I think, is a lot of people that come into kayak fishing for the fishing, not for the kayak.
Absolutely.
You know, and but then you can't help but get infected by the paddling side of it. And then you start to, I think, develop a different class of angler that now they appreciate both.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what does that demand? Okay, so now I want it all.
Performance
I want to be. Exactly. And I don't know. I think we're probably going to see a renaissance at some point.
Yeah, I believe that totally. Kind of scaled down because of all the everything coming with everything, kind of scaling down where everything's kind of simplified.
Yeah, and to me the wide, really big boats that are super comfortable, I mean, that's good stuff. I mean, that's options, you know. Not everybody has the same. Then, you know, it's funny, you get people very, very passionate sometimes, like, you know, we make products, so we hear both sides of it. We hear, all you really need is a, you know, kayak and a fishing rod. And when anybody asks me, what do you need to get started? Actually, the guy did the radio interview last night. He's like, what do you really need to put on your boat to start kayak fishing? I was like, fishing rod.
Mm-hmm.
You get a paddle if you want to move.
Yeah. Paddle if you want to move.
But, you know, what are you accomplishing when you go out and kayak fish? I mean, what are you accomplishing? You know, you're accomplishing, hopefully it's enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's probably some, you know, exercise benefits and all this kind of stuff. But at the end of the day, it's something that you do for, you know, personal fulfillment, something to have a good time, something to enjoy what you're doing, get outside and enjoy, you know, nature and the outdoors. If for some people that's a big boat that they can stand up in and feel super comfortable, you know, they're not trying to go 10 miles, that's great. You know, for somebody that says, well, I only want to go 10 miles, and, you know, as I've heard, if I could stand up in it, it means it's too slow. You know, hey, we're in an environment right now, it doesn't matter what you want, you can get it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's in it's because the manufacturers are listening.
Yeah.
You know, it's super cool.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to see a more and more meld to where at some point you can maybe accomplish more things with single crafts, you know, as it
well, because hole design, I keep seeing variances of hole designs and stuff like that. So people, they're always trying. They're always, everybody's, like, is it
innovation? Some of them are out of the box, right?
Yeah. Way out. Like, how does that even work?
Yeah.
I think that the demand is going to evolve. The type of things that people want, like you said, and ultimately the companies are listening.
Providing.
They're going to give what people want. I think their question is, what are we evolving to next? What's the next demand?
Yeah. It's having a basis covered, because I like to work, because I work at Appomattox, so I have, guys come in and say, I'm going to do inshore and lakes and stuff, and and I want comfort, or I want a good boat, I want a open water, so we got which is this narrow, all that stuff. So,
yeah,
you totally see that and how, but also you get guys who want to be able to do everything as well. Right now, if you want the comfort seat, but you kind of have this, but because you kind of have the Jacksons, but it's a little high for the open water gunnels, and you want that
seat. You got to pick those right days if you want to try to do that with that boat, but it's not out of the realm of possibility.
No, it's not, especially it's in the low seat, because that boat feels like it's crazy how you've ridden the Jackson Cuda.
Yeah.
It's because I rode it at the demo, and it was amazing how it felt in the low seat. I was like,
actually
good boat. Okay. I mean, regular, kind of just tarpon esque, kind of regular tarpon trident type of feeling boat. And I put it in the high seat, and I was like, a different boat. Yeah. It was a different boat. And I was like, wow, just that little bit of a difference,
Yeah, center of gravity.
A little bit. But I also feel that when I put, because I adjust my seats for just pads. I'll put a pad under. If I need my back, I'll put it down. If I'm paddling it, just little adjustments. I'm a Goldilocks when it comes to that stuff. I mean, seriously, like small adjustments to paddle, depending how we're about, it's ridiculous. I can feel like a weight wrong in the back. I need this over here. it's weird, man. It's really bad. But that's the thing is I can feel all that and with that pad and just that little bit of a difference. So even like little bits of difference can make that big of a difference. Something
he'll put five or gallon jugs of water and different places in this kayak.
Oh, I've lost before and gone, man, I gotta stop and fix that.
I think we've reached a conclusion, no cell block for Kevin.
Fishing license in the wrong pocket.
Yeah, cell block on one side of the
nope. Gotta put something over here now.
Put the fish in. Bait or something.
Yeah, I'm a Goldilocks. It's an app name, man. When I noticed it about myself a long time ago, I was like, wow, that's pretty bad. Like, I really noticed it when I was touring. Like every little details of stuff, because I'm in that boat every day.
And, so much time. Yeah.
So I was tripping out of myself, kind of. I was like, God damn, dude. How can you feel that weight? Yeah, I can feel that weight back there. How can you feel this? It's like that grain of sand that there's a no fairy tale, whatever. But the prince.
Yeah,
I'm that fucker too.
Goldilocks is gonna stick now.
Yeah, right? Goldilocks is right. Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Has Lee and all of them heard this already?
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Well, we're making that stick.
Yeah. Oh, it's. I call myself that to companies. He's trying to, why is there a quarter eighth an inch off of this paddle? I'm gonna feel that. You're not gonna feel that, you idiot.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, dude. Am I interrupting you guys right now?
Yep.
Oh, man. That's awesome. Dude, what time are you waking up tomorrow? What are your plans?
I'm not waking up early, so.
Okay, good.
Yeah, call me here in the morning, and I wake up like 7.
So that's your number off of him then?
I'm probably going to launch between 9 and 10.
Okay, cool.
Chicks Beach.
I'm going to write my number down for you, or should I hit you up on Facebook or something?
Yeah, do that.
All right, cool.
Yeah, don't say it on.
Have fun, dude. I want to go tomorrow.
Excuse me, John.
John, what's your last name?
Blair. Yeah,
good,
check your stuff out on Facebook all the time.
Right on, dude.
Awesome, both you guys.
Cool. Yeah, so, talk to me tomorrow morning.
All right, cool. All right, I'll see you guys then.
He's down there with Toast. He's this Toast buddy from up in Pennsylvania. He just had him on, and every time he was like, I want to catch a shark.
Yeah, is there going to be a recording of that somewhere? I could like.
Yeah, it'll be up in a couple days. It'll be on the next podcast. It'll be up.
Awesome.
Yeah, so he goes, oh, I want to catch a shark. I said, man, fuck a shark, dude. Catch a red. Sharks terrible ass fight.
there's a certain, I can see why. I mean, I can see it too,
but scrap that. Reds are here right now. Come on, you here tomorrow? That's everything.
I think there's a lot of people that, I mean, he's caught them off the beach and piers and whatever, but it's different than a kayak. When you're messing with a big shark in a kayak, I feel like it's
a legitimate bucket list.
I'm not putting it down. Especially me, because it helped me do what I wanted to do last year. Yeah. And I realized they are very different animals compared to normal fish.
That's my point. As in just straight fighting a big fish for your first kind of real big fish. Red or a stripe or something like that
understand that fight before you mess with
that's
the
what
shark
I was brightening up because how teeth. No they're sporadic
they're completely unpredictable
yeah.
And the thing is dealing with it when you think you're done fighting it what are you gonna I had a really hard time. I got really lucky.
What are you gonna do now, especially if you got some size, they fake their gun stuff.
They'll roll up on their belly like they're dead on the side of the boat, like two minutes into the fight.
They have 100% power.
You touch them, and they like you just hook them. And now you're going to fight them. Fuck those things, man.
I had fun with mine. I enjoyed it, but that's what I wrote in my blog post at the end. It's like, if you're not used to fighting big fish, do something else before you do that. Because that's not a good idea.
Yeah. I talked broad. I was like, you see. When he was bringing all this up, I was like, you saw Rob's video, right? Yeah, I saw that. You saw him almost get pulled in just trying to tail wrap that thing, right?
Twice. And how many, I actually almost lost my rod a couple times. And
yeah, cutbacks. Yep. But I understand it from people who are not around saltwater.
It's thrilling. It's exciting. Yeah. There's so much adrenaline that you're going to get out of that. And it's, but it's still, somebody's going to get hurt at some point.
It's not a fun fight. Just like cobia. Fucking cobia too.
Back to Goldilocks. You like a certain thing?
Reds and stripers, bulls and cows.
See, I'm just reds, man. I don't even give a fuck about stripers anymore either. I'm just like, it's such a hard season for us now. It's not like we go out, you know, back in 2006, 2007, and just whack them like we did, you know.
Yeah.
It's not, the fishery's been offshore a
lot. You're talking about strikers.
Yeah, fishery's been offshore a lot. It just hasn't been easy. It hasn't been as easy. Mm-hmm. I mean, last year we couldn't even, all they did was a small school of them were hanging off a plantation. We couldn't even get there. Mm-hmm. Just the weather wasn't right. We had to do a long drift. It's just, it was a pain in the ass.
And it was sporadic there. I mean, it wasn't, yeah.
Yeah, it was there, and they were still off of Ocean City. I mean, that's ridiculous. I mean, you usually come down, you guys will see in the next video all this. I'm repeating the same narration. I just really did
it shows in your report still. There was like right around, I'll take you like you said, 2006 and 7. It's like just before I actually started fishing with you, I remember seeing like, this is ridiculous, the number of fishing guys.
It was. You'd go out and we would catch.
And then the year that I started, it dropped off.
Yeah. Yeah, yours the last year because that one day was probably the last day. It was really good around the ships, and then it kind of tripled off since then. Yeah, it's not like, and I don't know if it's depletion of the species or whatever like that. And I know the commercial stuff is doing a lot to them, but they're offshore. I mean, there's fields of them offshore. I mean, like 10 miles off, 20 miles off, guys are running into them going out tuna fishing, going past them.
Schools.
Yeah, I mean, like
big
a lot.
Big cows.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. So it's not, it's just they're not, haven't been, they changed their migration.
Cycles or something.
Yeah.
Too,
yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah.
Dude, I think I'm on my jet, man. I gotta hit the road.
Cool, I'm glad you got you guys on here.
Appreciate it, man.
Just found a couple minutes. Alright, I'm gonna close it up. This is podcast number 31. I don't even remember which 32, one it was. 32. And thank you guys. And we're at the TKAA tournament, TKAA.org, heroesunderwater.org, projecthealingwaters.org, and yakattack.us. Thank you guys. Later.
Peace.